friends, welcome to the online worship of Covenant Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are with us. In the time that we are in, it is a special gift to be able to join with one another online. And we trust that God is with us wherever we may be. Here at Covenant, we believe that we belong to God, and that all belong to God. So we strive to live like we belong to one another. So whether you are tuning in for your first time with us this morning, or this is your 20th time, we want to remind you that no matter where you are on your journey of life, faith, and love, that you belong here. So thank you for joining us online. I want to take a moment to orientate you to worship in this hour this morning. If you are streaming with us on Facebook, take a moment to leave a comment in the comment section to connect with us. As the pastor, I am also worshiping alongside you this morning, and I want to be able to wish you a warm covenant welcome. We want to know that you, where you're worshiping from and how far God's connection and reach is with us this morning. So let us know also where you're from. We also want to offer to you this morning the opportunity to tell us your prayer requests so that we can pray for those that you know who are on your hearts this week and in the weeks ahead. We also want to give you the opportunity to give of your life, your talents, and your gifts this morning in our service. So begin thinking about the ways in which God is laying upon your heart this morning of giving back in gratitude all that we have been given. You can participate in many ways in our worship this morning. The bold print will invite you to your responses in our liturgy. We also invite you to sing the hymns along with us as we worship. Children are always welcomed here at worship, and so they are invited to participate in the entire worship service with a special time of psalm singing and a story for them in the middle of our service. So we hope you'll gather your children around if they are not worshiping with you the entire time for that special time with them. A reminder that today is a celebration, typically at Covenant, what we call Women's Sunday. We celebrate all the women of the church, not just our mothers, but we are delighted to invite you all to celebrate the women in your life, whether they are a newborn woman or a woman of 99, 100 years old. They all matter to us, and we hope that in this worship service and in your day today, that you honor those women who are special to you. So go ahead and take out your phone, a tablet, and send a text message to a woman that is important to you in your life, telling them this morning that you're thinking about them as an act of worship to God. A reminder that church doesn't end this morning when our live stream ends. There are multiple ways to dive deeper in faith and connect with us online. So we hope that you'll head over to our website or discover our Facebook page and the ways in which you are invited into discipleship opportunities throughout this week. We hope you'll join in one of those opportunities. Friends, God is here with you and with me and with all of us, wherever we are. So let us worship God this morning.
like to worship. People of God, God is our refuge. We have come to find refuge in the shelter of God's care. Come and sit. There is room for everyone in God's house. We have come to be nourished by God's word. We are God's own people and are precious in God's sight. We have come to give thanks for God's faithful love. Let us worship God.
To a time where we're invited to confess before God our sins and one another. So join me in the invitation to confession this morning. God promises that if we ask, we will receive. Jesus tells us to believe in Him so that our hearts may not be troubled. We do not need to languish in guilt or regret or shame. We can come in faith, trusting God's grace and mercy, confessing our sin to be forgiven and freed to live in joy. So let us confess our sins together this morning. Pray with me. Holy One, You are our fortress and our rock, the foundation on which all things are built. You have made us one family and one people, a holy priesthood, precious in Your sight. Yet we often pursue our own plans and ignore Your design for our lives. We reject those who are different than us and build walls that separate us from each other and from You. Forgive us, O God. Tear down the barriers we have put up and rescue us. Gather together the living stones of our lives and fashion us into a holy people, transformed by Your marvelous light of mercy and grace. Let us continue in silent prayer. let God's people say, Amen. Friends, this is the font of grace and mercy, of forgiveness and of love. Do not be troubled. Once we were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once we had not received mercy, but now we have received God's mercy. For in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen. Friends, we have been reconciled with God. Therefore, let us make our reconciliation with each other this morning. This is the passing of the peace, and so we ask that you do that safely with one another through a fist bump or a wave to those in the room with you. Feel free to take out your phone and pass the peace to someone in your life that you think might need that reconciliation and the peace of Christ at this moment. Also, you can pass the peace in our comment section of this live stream with one another. And the appropriate response will always be, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you and also with you. Share signs of peace this morning.
God is so good, God is so good, God is so good, He's so good to me.
Let us pray the prayer of the illumination. Like medium infants, our hungry spirits long to be fed. And like a loving parent, O God, you nourish us with your word. Open our hearts to the goodness of all that you have to say to us this day. Amen. The reading of the scripture this morning is 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 through 10. Hear the word of God. Like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation. If needed, you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to Him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices accepted to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, see, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in Him shall not be put to shame. To you then who believe, He is precious. righteous. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It's time for the psalm, and we call the children who are here forward for the psalm. So Moses and Miriam are here, and we've got a refrain sign. You guys can stay there on the pew if you want to. That's okay. That's all right. The psalm today is Psalm 31, a prayer of prayer and praise for deliverance from the enemies. And we're going to talk about God being a rock and a shelter and a fortress. So here's what our refrain sounds like. It's a different one. It goes like this. My God is a rock in a weary land, in a weary land. My God is a rock in a weary land, shelter in a time of storm. So Moses, Miriam, Joanna, and Pastor Lisa, anybody who's here, why don't you try singing that with me? Here goes our refrain. My God is a rock in a weary land, in a weary land. My God is a rock in a weary land, shelter in a time of storm. Psalm 31. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. Here's our refrain. Our God is a rock in a weary land, in a weary land. My God is a rock in a weary land, shelter in a time of storm. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Skipping to verse 15. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant and save me in your steadfast love. Refrain one more time. My God is a rock in a weary land, in a weary land. My God is a rock in a weary land, shelter in a time of storm. Here ends the psalm for today.
Thank you, Josh. We hope all the children are gathered at home. And Moses, Mary, I have some pictures this morning. And you may or may not know who these folks are, but in Scripture today, Jesus talks about going into a place where many dwellings, and when you see Jesus, you see the Father, or God. And so by recognizing Jesus, you recognize God's face as well. So it had me thinking about pictures this morning, and if you look at these two guys in my picture this morning, you'll notice that they look vastly familiar like I do. And guess what? They're my brothers. So, you can tell we all have the same big forehead. We all have the big bushy eyebrows. We're coming at you from a mile away. They all have dark hair. You know, I don't have as much facial hair as they have, thankfully, but we all look the same. You could tell we're related. So Moses, Mary, we could tell that you're related. You're a brother and sister. And who do you think, Mary, do you look like, mom or dad? Dad, for sure. Obviously. Moses, who do you look like? You think you look like mom? I don't think he wants to look like mom. You look like dad, maybe? I think you look like mom. So you can tell you probably look like one of your parents or maybe a combination of both. But when we're looking for Jesus, how do we know that we've seen God? So we see God in each other. There's some family resemblance there with Jesus. And so if you see Jesus, you have also seen God. And so I want you to go into your home, ask mom and dad about a picture of them, and then grandparents and maybe great-grandparents, and pick out who you see and see if you see some resemblance in your family there. Because that's what we do as Christians. We go around and see the Jesus in each other, and we recognize God as well. So how do you know that you've seen Jesus? It's a great question, right? Pictures. We know when we see love, and when we see grace, and when we see mercy. And so those are the characteristics that when I see that in Mary, I know I've seen Jesus, and in turn, I've seen God. And so that's a beautiful thing. And so that's what I want you to do today. Go look through some pictures on your mom's phone, your dad's phone, or maybe in a photo album, that ancient thing that we don't do any longer, and see if you can see the family resemblance. That would be really neat, because we do that as Christians as well. So do you think we can pray for our family resemblances this morning? You ready? Praying hands. You ready to pray? Dear God, thank you for families and appearing like each other. Help us to recognize love and grace and mercy. Amen. Thank you all. See you next time. Today's scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. Let us be attentive to God's living word this morning. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to Jesus, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to Jesus, Lord, well, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. And Jesus said to Philip, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me and his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and that the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. one of my favorite times is summer. Maybe yours as well. And this year, cicadas will be coming out in about a month, maybe a month and a half, 2 months now. And their appearance in our world will be remarkable. They are fascinating creatures of our Creator, and there are several types of cicadas that always emerge each year. You have your 17-year cicadas, the ones who have spent 17 years underground preparing for the day, the one day in which they will see this side of the topsoil. You have your annual cicadas that you will see year after year. And then you have the ones who will spend some time between year 1 and year 17 waiting for their time to emerge. The most perhaps fascinating thing, besides taking their time to emerge, is that they never emerge one by one. They somehow, underground, coordinate their effort to emerge together, sometimes coming out of the ground thousands by thousands in one night, ready to search for their mate, ready to find vegetation for food, and of course, to sing. To sing their song. You may have heard a cicada's song. It's emerged between a buzzing and a high-pitched shrill. It's a song that'll lay claim to your years of waiting, of years of transformation, and finally freedom for them. If you've ever seen this moment of emergence, you'll note that they come and change colors even. From white as a ghost as they're emerging to beautiful colors. You'll notice they'll have to flex their wings even to get a handle on all that is in the air. It is quite miraculous. And you'll notice that some will not emerge. Something has gone somewhere in their process wrong, only halfway emerging perhaps, and therefore never fully emerging. For some 17 years of growing and then the possibility of being stopped before the process is complete is a sad moment. All their work of growth comes to a halt. It seems unfair. Cicadas may not be your favorite or even on your radar as insects, but regardless, they will sing to us about life and a growth process that we might be living in. Their song sounds strange to us, but you know it when you hear it. Not because of its pitch, but rather it's strange to us because we are more tuned into melodies of productivity and impatience, maybe even forced control. Cicadas sing rather of a process that takes time, years and years. The God-given time for them to mature to what they were created to be. It's a song that is unfinished and never hurried. A song of many melodies and harmonies that always have to go together, never alone. It is a song we need to hear because we are so often estranged from the truth of how we are made and the process that we go through, of how we're asked to live with one another. But what if this year we listen to their song anew, of creatures who are not anxious but determined to live their process? They are, they could be, our resurrection teachers. Theirs is a resurrection song, and resurrection always has the power to abide in eternity. The mystery of the all in all. But we are so anxious right now about ourselves, about conflicts, about our lives, about our loneliness, about our pain, about this virus. But we can miss the ways in which God and the universe is singing to us or asking us to sing about who we are. Cicadas will emerge soon, and many of them have begun their journey years ago. Some 17, some a year ago, some 5, some 7. For some of us, that is quite the time we are living in, isn't it? Some of us have not emerged from our homes for possibly 60 days now, maybe even longer. We're still growing under that soil, waiting for the day when it's our turn to emerge. Others of us have emerged already after enough time, you say, has been spent. I feel like the last few months we have been deposited back into the earth in a way that we never have before. And a new emergence of time is yet to be determined. Many have begun their emergence, and we don't know yet if that is wise. This time is inviting us to a life that's not defined by control, but a way of life that is defined by bold vulnerability. One of the key things of circadias is that they must emerge together, never alone. If they leave by themselves, they leave themselves open to predators, to climate change that may have never been in their favor. It's wise to emerge together. So I'm curious how they will emerge this year. This strange time that we're living in, I wonder how they will do it. Will they do it as they always have, or will it be quite different? Some of that is already happening, and it makes me curious. Perhaps I am most curious, however, as how their song will be after they emerge. Will it be the same? Will it be a new song? What will it be? I'm also curious about what our song will be after this virus. Will it be full of resurrection and process, or will it be the same song we sang before we got into all of this? Will we have been buried under this only to emerge halfway undeveloped and a growth interrupted with a song that is incomplete? In a world that struggles right now to make and keep life so much of the time, I want to celebrate women today. We want to celebrate women. It is our custom here at Covenant. And we need more than one day to celebrate the women in our world and our lives, but today is a good day to start. One of my favorite recent movies is Harriet, a celebration of a woman who put her life on the line so that all could emerge together. Women across our lives, mothers and sisters, aunts and nieces, granddaughters and daughters and friends and mentors, they teach us the ways in which we can be present to one another and alive in a world in such a way that we can respond with one another. There's something about women and the song they sing that gives us life. I'm thankful for the many women in my life who continue to lead songs of life that I can hear and helps me emerge from a darkened place to join my place in the song. Women are notorious for having the power and the ability to respond and adapt to life wherever they are. The movie Harriet is a prime example. I believe all of this capacity is not just for women. They just tend to do it better. Which has me thinking about Jesus and his words in our passage this morning. His song in the 14th chapter of John is one of reassurance and safety and love. He says, "I go to prepare a place for you that will have many rooms." Many of us have attributed that phrase to heaven, and perhaps this is why we spend much of our time trying to obtain that golden key to that eternity door, but it was never a door to begin with. Jesus goes to prepare a place for us as he has already done here on earth, and rather than a door, what if we thought of it as a sanctuary? A place where we can take refuge in God and know fully who we are. What does it mean to have sanctuary or be a sanctuary or prepare a place for sanctuary? sounds like a lofty few questions there during this time. And I see him here this morning in this sanctuary of Covenant Presbyterian. Many of us would simply like to be back here in this place, make our way quick to be back and in the familiar. Some of us are ready to distance ourselves from this place for many months from now until we're absolutely sure that nothing will harm any of us. And some of us are in the land of a wilderness and somewhere between those two. All of us, I would guess, still want to see sanctuary, though. Perhaps this place, perhaps the place where you feel safe and healthy, could be your home, could be your family, maybe it's this world. I think the most trying part of what we're going through is our definition of sanctuary has changed, and there's some grief with that. Places we would have named as sanctuaries are no longer those places for us. They carry new names, new meanings, new fears, new vulnerabilities. Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you with many rooms. And we're wondering, like Philip, how do we get there? How do we get there, and how do we get there quickly? It would be a relief if we knew what sanctuary will look like after this. It would be a relief if we were especially clear on some kind of confirmation that we're doing what is necessary for sanctuaries to emerge again. Redefining the word sanctuary is a vulnerable way to be in this world right now. What can be said and spent in isolation could be seen as just time thrown away. But I wonder if it could be a moment of truth about our sanctuary. And what can feel like a straining to see a greater purpose, inconsequently, may be the way for us to see this world in a new way. I wonder if we could take our cues from the Cicadios right now. Can we redefine what it means to be a sanctuary, to have sanctuary, to feel safe, to have refuge, to feel like we can still live? Those are my questions right now, especially when I see people like Ahmaud Arbery, who gets killed for jogging in his neighborhood. What happened to his sanctuary? Or the McDonald's employees who were shot because we could not dine in at our McDonald's. What happened to their sanctuary? I have been thinking about sanctuaries as we have gone along, and Jesus' words, I go to prepare a place for you with many rooms, but I feel like we are only concerned with our own room. What if there was just one definition, though, of sanctuary that has not changed through all of this? God's sanctuary for us, the home God has prepared for us and to us. You see, God still fills the world with messages of heroic life-keeping. And these are not about dominance or control. They're not quick solutions, and they're not a one-size-fits-all, and maybe that's our problem. No, these ways of God's sanctuary have deep connections. They have a primordial hum of not being anxious, but determined. Because let's be honest, we're fragile, we're tangled up in this world, and we are only concerned about ourselves. But imagine a world where ambiguity and process are not the enemy, but rather the way to sing a resurrection song. Because underneath the deepest, darkest caverns, that is where we are right now. There's a will to be transformed, I believe. Do not let your hearts be troubled, Jesus begins. Let your hearts be who they were made to be. We may have lost a lot of our false sanctuaries, and that makes us anxious in these past few months. Yet we have not lost the thing that gives us refuge, and that is God. The one that continues to ask us to sing, continue to remind us that we too have a song to sing and a song that must include all the voices. And so this week, I want you to think about sanctuaries. Maybe this one that we sit in and I stand in that you long to see again. Maybe the one you're sitting in today, your home or your family. I want you to think about the sanctuaries that you prepare for others. When, how does that happen? And then I want you to sit and listen for the song. The song that rises not out of anxiousness, but determination to be sung. I hope you've seen the movie, Harriet. If you haven't, you should. There's a song that took many years to emerge in that movie that I think resonates in our time. And I hope we can take that to heart as we emerge from this virus and that we can sing a new song. For if we rise alone, we do not rise. Predators will come after us. We will be at each other. Jesus came not for one, but for all. So may we too sing the song of the Cicadias, the resurrection song after the years or months or however long this burial might be. And so listen to the song from Harriet. I've been walking with my face turned to the sun, weight on my shoulders, a bullet in my gun. I got eyes in the back of my head just in case I have to run. I do what I can, when I can, while I can, for my people. While the clouds roll back and the stars for the night, that's when I'm going to stand up. Take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to answer. Going to keep on keeping on. I can feel it in my bones. Early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, we're going to start moving toward that separating line. I'm wading through muddy waters. You know that I got my mind made up. And I don't mind if I lose any blood on the way to salvation. And I'll fight with the strength that I got until I die. So I'm going to stand up. Take my people with me. Together we're going to a brand new home. Far across the river. Can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to answer. Going to keep on keeping on. And I know what's around the bend might be hard to face because I feel alone. And I just might fail, but Lord knows I try. Sure as stars fill up the sky, stand up. Take my people with me. Together we're going to a brand new home. Far across that river, can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to answer, I'm going to take my people with me. I go to prepare a place for you. I go to prepare a place for you. Sanctuaries. We have the power to emerge together. Let us sing the resurrection song for us all. Amen.
Spirit, oh, sing to our God, oh, Jesus is Lord. Amen, alleluia, for Jesus is Lord. Amen, alleluia, for Jesus is Lord. Amen, alleluia, we'll sing to our God, we'll sing to our God.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and stood upon the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From him shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We come to a time in our worship service that we will pray for those that we know of this past week and in the previous weeks. Again, we invite you to share your prayer requests with us now so that we can pray with them this morning and also in the weeks ahead. We love joys and concerns here. We lift them all up to God, so all are appropriate. Keep in your prayers this morning as joys the women of our lives. Again, take a moment to text those women if you haven't already that are important to you this day. We also give thanks for Sarah McGinn, who is a high school student with us, a senior, and she is valedictorian of Sherman High School, and we are so proud of her, and we lift her up this morning. We're also proud of all of our graduates and those graduating in whatever form they can, whether high school, college, or into different professions. We are proud of you, and we are so grateful to share in your many gifts and many blessings. We also are grateful for being able to see church family faces through fellowship right after this worship service. So in the comment section, I am posting currently about how you can join that fellowship of 30 minutes of seeing each other's faces and welcoming one another again. We give thanks that Jerry, the friend of Dorothy Wells, is home and recovering with physical therapy, and we give thanks for her friend and her recovery. We are grateful that Betty Stevens has tested COVID negative, and so we are grateful that her exposure was not an infection, and we are grateful. We give thanks for birthdays and anniversaries that are being celebrated throughout the weeks, and we are grateful to celebrate with you. We are also delighted that Abby Vaughn, who is the granddaughter of Phyllis and Chuck Vaughn, members of Covenant, she is also valedictorian of her high school, Bonner Springs High School, and we delight in Abby's success and also proud grandparents of Abby. We also give thanks that Chuck Manning is also COVID negative in his test results this week, and we give thanks for him and his family and pray continually for his co-workers who are receiving their results as well. Keep also in your prayers Cooper, the grandson of Bob and Ruthie Warner, who had a bad accident and will turn 9 this past week. And so prayers that for his recovery, but also for Bob and Ruthie as they keep the rest of the grandkids at this time. We also pray for Chris Fry, the son of Jim and Cindy Fry, who's dealing with an infection and also subsequent health issues because of that infection. We pray for Jim Fry as he continues to recover from his heart cath this week. We also pray for Rich Toms, who is also having some health concerns at this time. We also give thanks that Jerry Reed has undergone his eye procedure and it went well, and we continue to pray for his health concerns. And we also pray for all of those who are struggling during this time. We are with you. So let us go to God in prayer. Oh God, sometimes we feel so alone and unprepared and honestly just exhausted. Sometimes we feel forgotten and stepped upon. Lord, remind us in this time to breathe, to look outward, and to also look inward. Lord, remind us that in praying we are doing your will. Help us to examine ourselves and prepare for each day, knowing that you go ahead of us in leading us, speaking to us, and touching each of our lives with great love. We are steeped in news and stories that make us weep and grow sad, O God, reminding us of so many vulnerabilities and so much human loss. Help us to set down our fears and burdens, to find sleep, to have healing dreams that connect us powerfully to you and all of your creation. O God, may we know what it means when our hearts are inscribed by the Holy Spirit. Guide us, awaken us, refresh us, comfort us. May we come face to face with the stranger and understand this great and wondrous, mysterious love you have given us. For those who work in fire and rescue, in emergency rooms and ICUs, with ventilators and monitors, with beeping and lights, before them, feverish humans completely dependent on their gifts, God, we ask for your compassion. Sustain those who give of their mind and body and spirit to care and to heal and to restore. We continue to grieve as we hear of more deaths and even suicides at the stress and risk of being on the front lines. Shelter these intelligent and deeply caring souls in your eternal time. We grieve with families. We grieve with those newly diagnosed, those who have died, and those who are struggling to heal and find a way in this life. So many directions to work, God. Have mercy. For the firefighters in Ukraine who are battling forest fires around Chernobyl, where radioactive ash and smoke is ascending and spreading beyond borders, Lord, have mercy on us. For those who donate their time and talents and money and volunteering in many ways in shelters and food banks and tending neighbors and providing care to children, for summer camps who have turned their sites and to places of respite and quarantine to have warm meals for folks. A little goes such a long way. A tear can be wiped or watched to fall, and help us be present in these moments. Lord, have compassion for our desire to do things we can do. Love us when we feel we can't do enough or figure things out fast enough. Help us to remember those who are forgotten, the not newsworthy, the last year's news, or the living in the wrong time and space. Break down our prejudices and hatred. Shake apart our sinfulness and false righteousness that have nothing to do with compassion or your goodwill. May our masks that we wear speak of our love and care to one another, to be a symbol of open-heartedness. Teach our eyes to smile, our eyebrows to lift in welcome, and show those funny, awkward, distant embraces as we wrap ourselves when we can once again see one another. Cause us to wave and yell hello from our windows as loud as we can. Lord, it is great to hear of gifts to be celebrated in new ways for our graduates, for Sarah and for Abby being valedictorian of their class, for Chuck and for Betty for being COVID negative, for birthdays and anniversaries, for fellowship, for the women in our lives. We give you thanks and we are grateful for all of these joys that bring smile and warmth to our hearts. We pray, O God, for those who continue to battle things in these difficult times, for Cooper and Chris and Jim and Rich and Jerry, and those who find this time traveling to be a great, great obstacle. We lay them before you, O God. Help us to have compassion from distances for them. Make our prayers surround them and uplift them and uphold them. Remind us, O God, that a virus can cause suffering, but we are your healing hands. May we do your will and see your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. We pray, we work, we give, and we offer our very lives to you this morning. For we pray as Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come to a time where we have an opportunity to offer our very lives back to God, along with our talents and our monetary offerings. So this morning, there are ways that you can give to the ministries here at Covenant that continue to support our city, our county, our nation, and our world. We ask that you can give online at www.cpcsherman.org/giving. All of your donations can be designated in ways in which you know that we help our community and world, and we hope that you will continue to give as you have so freely given in the weeks past. And so for that, we want to say thank you. If you would like to write us a check, we also accept those at 322 West Pecan Street, Sherman, Texas, 75090. But perhaps more importantly during this time, we hope that you'll offer your life back to God in creative ways of giving of yourself in your discipleship in love and grace and mercy. So, loving God, you have made us your people so that we may speak of your wonderful acts, that we may witness to your wonderful acts with gratitude for all that we have received. We come to offer our gifts to you this day. Let us present all of our gifts to God. Thank you. Join me in our prayer of dedication. O God, may these offerings be acceptable to you. In a world facing profound need, we know that in your hands, even small things become great. Use these gifts in our very lives to make this world a home where all are sheltered, nourished, and cherished. Amen. Blessing and benediction as we go to live into this world this day. Once we were not a people, but now we are God's people. God's face shines on us. God's faithful love saves us. This news is too good to keep to ourselves. Everywhere we go, we will share the good news of God's amazing love.